and welcome to the Milan Records Podcast. I'm your host Tony Giles from the Damn Fine Cast and Blumhouse.com, and on today's episode I'll be in conversation with Brooke and Will Blair discussing the upcoming Milan Records release, Green Room. Joining me now on the Milan Records Podcast are Will and Brooke Blair, composers of the upcoming Milan Records release, Green Room. How are you doing today, guys?
Great.
We're fantastic. Thanks for having us, Tony.
I'm very, very pleased to be able to have this opportunity to speak to you today. I've been listening to Green Room for a few weeks now. I absolutely love it. But then saying that, I absolutely love what you've done in the past as well. I particularly liked Blue Ruin. It made my top... one of my top picks of 2015, actually. I just a big fan of that, and a big fan of Blackest Rainbow, the guys in the UK that put it out on vinyl.
Right. Well. Oh, right. Yeah.
Praise well, thank these you. Guys. No, thank problem you. At all. To kick things off, I always like to start off with a very simple, very easy question I like to ask all my guests. It's about your musical background. Now, I've never actually interviewed a composing duo, let alone a composing duo who happened to be brothers. Now, did one of you start down the musical path first and the other join, or did you discover at the same time?
It was pretty much the exact same time. There's always instruments laying around our house, and our dad's a guitar player and an instrument builder. So we got started pretty early at a young age, and kind of whatever I picked up, we would do the opposite of. So over the years, we've developed different expertise on different instruments that don't really overlap too much. So that's something that's kind of worked to our advantage. Being able to play a wide range of instruments. And it kind of just started maybe like elementary school, and then we played in a bunch of different bands over the years.
Have you slowly. Always worked together?
We haven't. I would say it. The discovery probably took place at the same time, literally in the basement with a acoustic guitar and a piano, and eventually drums showed up and we went from there. But I think our school years, you know, elementary school, grade school, even high school, we were very close in age, about a year and a half in age, but had our own separate projects with our own group of friends. Perhaps a little competitive, maybe, in a healthy way. And we ended up at the same college. So I think right as adulthood, 18, 19-year-olds, we were just old enough to decide that we were probably stronger musically as a pair. Mm-hmm. And with the exception of a few small little solo projects, maybe we've been working together since then. Yeah.
Oh, cool. Was the idea to always go into the composing world, or did the idea of a band, something like that, was that a possibility as well?
It was pretty much always band related. That was kind of the goal for the longest time. Like a lot of young musicians, the goal was to get in a tour bus and get a record deal and all that kind of stuff. And we did a good bit of touring, but never really got to the record deal phase of things. We released a bunch of independent records and just learned how to do it. And all along, we kind of were learning how to record and teaching ourselves that world as well. And in between band projects, you know, student film projects and films that our friends were making would pop up, and they would always come to us and ask for music. And so something that just kind of organically happened, but it was never the ultimate goal.
Gotcha.
To be in film. It just kind of, we ended up here.
Yeah.
It starts to work when there's a bit more age, I think. In other words, at college or in your early 20s, so to speak, there's something more immediately gratifying about the band thing. You know, you're on stage and it's all, there's so much action, so to speak, and very instant sort of, whereas the film composition world requires so much more patience, you know, to write and work on the same project for months on end, and then maybe you're not able to share it with an audience for another year after your work is done. And it's this much longer process. And I think we wouldn't have been, you know, patient enough perhaps as youngsters. But we got into it at a time that felt very natural.
Oh, cool. Were you both fans of film, you know, growing up, and are you still fans of film now?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. In fact, while we were learning to play instruments, we also, in the basement bathroom of our parents' house, we had a little special effects lab with liquid latex and fake blood and all that stuff. I think early on, too, we were really drawn to the behind-the-scenes aspect of filmmaking and what went into all the magic behind films. And, yeah, and then a big part of that was being aware of the role that music played. And especially when it seemed to, we got our first little taste of certain projects that didn't necessarily feature the big, sweeping Hollywood orchestrated scores. That's when it kind of started to really stick out as being something that maybe we could dabble in, and it maybe felt like this is something we could do. Okay. You know, stuff like Twin Peaks, Angelo Badalamenti, and John Carpenter type stuff. You know, the more simple, stripped down. Smaller scope, you know?
Yeah, I got you. Were these, these were the guys that were influencing you musically. Was there any groups or bands around at the same time that were doing the same thing? You know, I've had a few people cite sort of Nine Inch Nails or Trent Reznor when he's doing the more quiet Nine Inch Nails stuff as, you know, as an influence on their soundtrack careers. Was there anyone like that for you?
I think all of the different projects we've been in, and we sort of explored different genres over the years, but we've been told that they always had sort of like an emotional weight to it and almost described as cinematic. So there was groups like that we grew up with that, at the top of my head right now, The Cure, for example, you know, a band like The Pixies, maybe again, not as atmospheric, not as cinematic, but yeah, they definitely spoke to us quite a bit. We were fortunate to have a third older brother who's a few years older than us, and he is involved in film, acting and writing and producing as well. But we felt a treat to sort of be exposed to what we would consider pretty good music at a young age through our older brother. And yeah, someone like them, anyone else come to mind? There's a band from near you called The. And they were a big part of what we grew up listening to. Again, The Cure, mm-hmm. New Order, Depeche Mode. A lot of stuff from your neck of the woods, to be honest. Yeah.
I believe, actually, is your brother one of the producers on Green Room?
He's one of the producers. He has a supportive role in Green Room. He is actually, if you had a chance to see Blue Room, he's the lead actor
in Blue Room. Right, yeah.
He plays Dwight with the beard and
the
stabbing and such.
It's a powerful film. If anyone listening to this hasn't seen Blue Room, I mean, you should check it out because the score is fantastic. But the film itself, it's one of those films that I watched not knowing very much about it at all. I don't even think I'd seen the trailer, and someone had recommended to me and said, look, you need to see this film Blue Ruin. And I was like, oh, okay, fair enough. And going into it without knowing what the film was about, it completely blew my mind. It was a very powerful drama. And I think one of the things that helped the drama in the film was the score that you had created for it.
Oh, thank you. Jeremy Sarnay, the director, is obviously, if you've seen the movie, you know, tension and suspense is something he does very well. And with that score in particular, not the first time we had worked with Jeremy, but maybe the first, we knew this movie was going to be a little different, and maybe expectations were higher, and I don't want to say pressure, but there was just more focus on it. And he was very, very hands-on, and you know, I give him a lot of credit. What he sort of lacks in a musical vocabulary, he makes up for it with a very, very firm vision, kind of on a scene-to-scene, frame-to-frame basis, that he knows not what notes need to be played, but just how it needs to feel and how it needs to work. So it was a lot of on-the-job learning with that project.
So it's almost like a collaborative effort in that way then.
Oh, yeah, it was fairly unique in that we didn't have a very long time to work on it. Crazy enough, we did that in about 5 or 6 days around the clock nonstop.
Yes.
and even crazier, Jeremy was in the room for every minute of that, which is, I think, a very odd and unique situation. We've never done that since, you know, prior. It's a unique situation, but the clock was ticking and we had a deadline, and you know, he wanted to be right there in the thick of it, and I think there's something really immediate and intense about it, especially because it had, you know, we didn't have the benefit to rethink and overthink and add too much to it. We just kind of had to go with a lot of gut instinct, and that may kind of add to the tension of the overall sound.
How was it working under that kind of pressure? I mean, did that inspire you or spur you on, or is it something that you'd like to shy away from? I know that Disaster Piece recently complained about how short the schedules can be sometimes, you know, given to composers to, you know, create magic, as it were.
Yes, an unrealistic schedule, but to be honest, we really love what we get to do, and so it's very exciting because the deadline was a big film festival, and that's just exciting to look forward to. So that kept our sort of energy going. But I'll say this, you know, again, a unique experience in that we've worked with Jeremy before, and we grew up with Jeremy, and we've spent time since we were children with him, and our families know each other well, and there's a friendship, and with that comes a lot of comfort. I think there's some director-composer relationships that are very polite and very respectful and very, and this one is, of course, but he had no problem running out of patience and letting us know. And we would get, you know, we only got a few hours of sleep the night before, and we would get testy with each other. Oftentimes we stayed completely focused, but it got tense in the room. And I do think that contributed to some of the music that we made.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's tense and tension is a word that I would, or a term I would use to describe the score for Blue Ruin. I mean, it's the soundtrack is, you know, it's one of those things that It's one of those albums that I have this thing where there's certain albums I won't play at night or at certain times in the day because they will genuinely put me on edge. And Blue Ruin is definitely one of those. It really does bring this kind of, this level of intensity that you don't, I personally haven't heard a lot recently and even in the past as well. So the pressure, it seems to have worked for you very well. It's definitely come across. And as you mentioned before, you have worked with Jeremy a few times. But if we can, I want to go back a little bit into your musical education. Now, you mentioned that you guys both started at home, basically, as children. Did you then go on to have any kind of formal musical training?
Again, we ended up at the same college, and I did pursue a formal music education at college with a focus on classical and jazz percussion performance. And after 4 years, I did learn a lot. A lot of it does apply to what we do today, but to be honest, Brooke is much more impressively self-taught, and in some ways it came quicker and more natural to him. I wanted to study more, but really, again, almost all of our real world experience is writing, recording, performing our own music with the people that we choose to, rather than formal studies, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
There was something about the intensity of that, you know, level of musical education that it wasn't collaborative. You know, it was very solitary, and it was you have to be very focused and very driven. But it was not really collaborative with other people in the way that film is. So there's something about it was missing for me.
How did you guys then, when you decided to work together, how did you then break into composing for film?
A lot of the early stuff was just student projects. You know, it was around the time that we were in college, and like I said earlier, it was just friends doing short films and wanting original music and not knowing where to turn, and that allowed us to kind of learn on the job and figure out how to do it and what not to do, and you know, you kind of stumble, and that's a good place to learn. And so yeah, we never had the situation where we studied under anyone or were assistants or ghostwriting or anything like that. It was just pretty much just getting thrown in and doing it, and you know, trying to learn with each film and get a little better at it. And then a big part of it was Jeremy kind of taking us along. His first feature was in 2007, so that was our first full-length feature. And, you know, that was like the rude awakening for like really how it needs to be done, how delivery goes. And it was definitely a different level of professionalism that was new to us at that time. So, and every project since then is just learning and trying to get better at it, you know, figure out the process. And the teams get bigger and bigger, you know, and finally there's, you know, music editors and supervisors involved, and it kind of changes the dynamic. But then we're still learning.
No, I mean,
how to do it.
Hopefully it's one of those things that you'll never stop learning or picking things up, you know,
right,
as you go along. And as you mentioned before, this is the third time you've worked with Jeremy Saunier, as I'm told is how you are the correct way to pronounce his name, because I have been saying it wrong for quite a while now. So thank you for clearing that for me. We talked about Murder Party, and then we talked about Blue Ruin a bit. And now we are here today talking about the upcoming film Green Room. Now, has there been the three films that you've worked on together as a trio? Has there been a progression in the relationship when it comes to his input in what you're doing?
Yes, I think so. With Murder Party, again, we were very uncertain of our, you know, are we going to be able to do this? And he really kind of dragged us in and said, you don't have much of a choice. Let's figure out how to do this together.
Right.
Blue Ruin, I think we had more ideas to bring to the table, perhaps more things to experiment with, more ideas that he welcomed, but ultimately he was an equal collaborator and just as hands-on with that project. And again, part of that was this unusual schedule that he wanted to just make sure we stayed on. With with Green Room, it was still a relative to other things we've done. It was a pretty intense schedule. But he offered us quite a bit more freedom, and we did the majority of the work on our own, and we brought a bunch of bigger sort of conceptual ideas early on, and he had plenty of input, but I think there was, I'm not sure if trust is the word, but there was just sort of a relaxation a little bit that we could sort of independently focus on this a little bit more, and with sort of final approval, so to speak, from Jeremy. I think Jeremy likes to be hands-on in this part of the process in such a very detailed way, not because of, I think he just loves making movies. He just loves every aspect of it. He loves seeing it go through different levels of completions. I think it's exciting for him. It's exciting for all of us. So I think that's why he likes to jump in. But he often knows very intuitively how music can affect the audience and the picture. And, so it's been he's been a great teacher.
Yeah. I mean, Green Room, the movie, isn't actually out over here yet in the UK where we're recording this, so I haven't had a chance to see it yet. But I do get a sense, watching the trailer, reading a little bit about the film, and then listening to the score, I do get a sense, you know, of what the film is actually about, how the music plays a part in the film. It does bring that level of tension that your work does. It creates a very wonderful atmosphere as well. It's, in a way... your scores are almost like soundscapes. They plant ideas. At least this is how I find them. And from that, you know, I can start to piece things in my own mind. What can you tell us about this score for Green Room?
I think you kind of hit on it too with the picking up on the atmospheric side of it. It's especially with Jeremy's films in particular. He really pushes us to go into a place where the score is there, you know, you're maybe not totally aware of it. It's a little bit invisible. It does kind of bleed into sound design a bit. You know, you don't really know where one starts and one ends up. And that's always kind of been the approach specifically with Jeremy's films. And in this one, there's an awful lot of, like source punk and rock and heavy metal going on, so we really had to kind of work with that and around it, and you know, move the story along, but do it in a pretty invisible way, if that makes any sense.
No, it does totally.
Yeah, and a lot of it's just about staying out of the way, but then still laying a kind of bed that's keeping it moving and setting a mood and a feeling without, you know, knocking you over the head with it.
I gotcha. Given as I've said, I haven't seen the film, but reading about the film and given that the film is quite horrific in places and quite violent in places, did you approach the score in a different way to convey, you know, kind of what you're seeing on screen is horrific, but you know, what you're feeling, what we're bringing to you is making you feel that kind of 10 times more.
Yes, I think there was, again, a minimal approach, and we've done this with, I think this happens naturally, is that maybe a tendency for a lot of composers to start in the early phase of a film, perhaps overscoring, over layering, over composing, perhaps, and then it becomes a subtractive process, sort of removing what might be distracting, what might be too dense or too much. And Jeremy's, you know, with this project in particular, his goal is always just realism. And, you know, as long as the characters are existing in this world and the dialogue is something that people would actually say and the costumes are something that people would actually wear, you know, he needs the music to be grounded and, almost a feeling rather than a tune or a melody, so to speak. Yeah. So we would, if we, in certain sequences that do become violent and do become kind of action-packed and disturbing all at the same time, I think we started with more than we needed, and we trusted the sound design department. That's a big thing with Jeremy, and it's when you can kind of look how he puts it together, there's just as much tension and discomfort created by the sound design and the mix of that. I mean, there's a few scenes with dogs, for example, and dogs that are used, without spoiling anything, for hunting, so to speak, you know, protective reasons.
Yes,
And they are they are apparently the sweetest dogs in the world on set, but the characters of the dogs are absolutely horrifying. And some of the sounds that come from these animals are just as scary as any music we can make. So we trusted that. We realized, let's remove a few layers, or let's switch gears a little bit to allow room for other sonic things to do a lot of the work too. So I think at the end of the day, it we erred on the minimal side of things. This one in particular, we were very hands-on with the music editor and the sound designers. We don't always get the luxury of being included in the final mix of a movie, but this one we were, and we all put it together as a team, it felt like.
And we also, going into it this time, we knew, based on Blue Ruin, how Jeremy was going to deal with the sound design.
Right, okay.
And the atmospheric side of the film. So I think we had a better understanding of how we might fit in this time around, which was a big help. Yeah.
That's cool. I mean, you mentioned before, and anyone that picks up the soundtrack will know, that there are a bunch of songs. The soundtrack is, in essence, exactly that. It's a soundtrack. It's a mixture of score and songs from the film. And the film is based in the punk hardcore world. And there's a ton of great songs on the soundtrack. I'm an old punk hardcore fan myself, so listening to this stuff is perfect for me because I get my soundtrack fixed, but I also get to listen to Napalm Death tracks and stuff, and which is fantastic. Did you guys have any input into the actual songs that were used in the film? Are you guys fans of that kind of music?
We are fans. It's part of the world we grew up around in Northern Virginia, right outside Washington, D.C., which has a big,
wow,
you know, Fugazi, Minor Threat, yeah, Bad Brain.
That's like the mecca of every punk band. I seem to love Fugazi, Bad Brains, Black Flag, Minor Threat. Yep. They're all Washington bands. So.
Yeah, of course. And a good bit of ska music and things like that. And Jeremy was just a year or two older than us and very interested in that music and that scene, and we picked up a lot from that. We didn't have as much direct input in the selection of the songs or the recording of the other rock and roll songs. We did, we worked hard to make sure the score complemented that and could weave in between all of those songs in a cohesive way and fit into the world without writing a punk rock score, without writing even a rock and roll score. An early approach that we had that made it into the score, we recorded pretty much a full day in the studio very early on worth of feedback. You know, a microphone is turned up too loud and it starts to squeal, or an electric guitar can screech and squeal in kind of an uncomfortable way. So something that you would normally try to avoid in a recording studio or a live, we tried to encourage and turn up and capture. And then we took, so we were starting with just very raw, basic snippets of feedback, and we're able to use a program that we use that we can layer them and essentially build sort of custom playable keyboard-based musical instruments. But the origins of the sounds were in feedback to us without sounding like a microphone necessarily or a guitar necessarily. Gotcha. It did have sort of a punk rock, unruly, uncontrollable, and uncomfortable origins to the sounds themselves. Maybe that made up a good percentage of the instruments we chose to use for the score.
Oh, that's very interesting. Did you guys, were you composing to a script or were you using an early cut of the film?
We actually did, when we started developing these feedback virtual instruments, just to kind of see how they might work, we put together a good amount of demos for this before, and that was based off the script, just reading that. And
before they shot, yeah.
Before they shot, yeah. We did the same thing with Blue Ruin as well, where, you know, early on there's a script and we're lucky enough to kind of get a peek at it and then start working on some ideas. And it's a really fun way to do it because you're not tied to picture. It's just throwing ideas out and you never have any clue where they're going to go, and most of them don't work. But what happened on both these films was that a handful of those actually made it into the film. These kind of demo ideas that we didn't try to rethink and refine and reapproach, but there was just something very raw and immediate in those early demos that Jeremy reacted to. And so now we're aware of any early demos are completely on the table and they might end up in the final cut regardless of what we say.
Yeah.
So, but then the bulk of the work is to picture, a fairly rough edit. And then as that gets refined, we kind of work tighter and tighter to picture. And then, you know, there's finally a lock picture, and we, we're finalizing all the cues at that point.
Was there a preference for you then? Is it good to have the script and make the demos, or would you prefer to just, or do you prefer just going in and actually, you know, you can see what's happening on screen, so you just work straight to what is going to happen?
I think again, we would all agree that just having as much time as possible is a luxury. Deadlines are good, but in these situations, we were, like you said, with the relationship with Jeremy, we were able to start early without much pressure, without a clock to stick to. But so that is kind of a luxury to get started early in the demo phase. What we've, like Brooke said, any of that, if it catches Jeremy's ear in a certain way, it is subject to make it into the film. So it does become nerve-wracking where for example, this happened with Blue Ruin, and we said, you know, that idea only took 20 minutes, and we didn't think much about it. We just tried to capture a quick mood, and he said, well, it's the right mood for the first scene of the movie in that case. And we begged him to let us try, you know, a second, third, and fourth version to see if we could compose it a bit more, and we all agreed that the first one is working the best for a certain reason, and not too much thought went into it. It's more, like I said, capture.
I've actually spoke to a few composers now, and it seems that some directors do seem to kind of have this perverse love of doing that, just coming in and, oh, what was that? Play that again. Yeah, that's perfect. And I was just sitting here playing chopsticks. It's like, that's perfect. We'll use that.
Yeah.
It does seem, though, that with the tone of the film and it being kind of this punk and this hardcore thing, that the demo ethic, in a way, seems to work quite well for the score.
Yeah, that's a great observation. Our goal was to first and foremost support all the tension that Jeremy's creating and maintain that tension, but again also just blend into the existing music and the existing sort of aesthetic that's in the film itself.
Thank you. Have you seen the film yet with an audience?
I haven't yet. Will's been lucky enough to.
Yes, I've been able to get to a Fantastic Fest in Austin and the Sundance Film Festival just back in January. And two very different audiences and different sized audiences. But they were, it does, especially after having quite a few months away from it, it does a different level of excitement is kind of experiencing it again in a room full of strangers.
Yeah. Are you able to kind of distance yourself enough to sit and watch and enjoy the film?
I found myself knowing exactly what was going to happen every second of the way, but I still got very, very tense. Yes. Right. My heart was racing. The blood pressure was rising. Yes. It's a uncomfortable thing to sit through.
Yeah. I mean, I've been wanting to see the film for a while now. It's been one of those films that's kind of been on a list, and it's slowly, because you read about these things at the festivals and you're like, well, when is this damn thing going to come out? But it's coming out very soon. And I literally cannot wait for it to come out over here, just because I've been listening to the score so damn much. And I have these pictures in my head. The UK is, or was, known for a certain, you know, kind of, violence, or some of the storyline that's incorporated into Green Room. We had some of those problems here in the UK in the 1980s, and when I grew up, I mean, it was stuff that was in the news, so I did read about it and I did know about it, that kind of thing. So I'm kind of I can't wait to see it, to see how the score fits in the film, and see if any of the images I have in my head actually play out, or more of a feeling, see if that plays out. Now, this is the third time, as we've mentioned before, that you've worked with Jeremy. Are there any plans to carry on the relationship?
We're looking at each other and smiling. We would, of course, we would love to. We feel more in tune with his style of filmmaking and his needs and his wants with each project. We also feel a bit more capable of bringing our own new perspective to his films. So I think it will. I think it's,
there's some loose plans, maybe.
There's loose plans, and we're talking early, and we've read the script of what might be his next project, and that's very exciting. And we've actually begun these very early demos that we just mentioned. And there's plenty of time. There's nothing has been shot yet, and nothing has been cast yet, but it'd be really interesting to see what some of the guys that we look up to as composers could do in Jeremy's movies as well.
No. I don't agree with that at all.
Well, that must be kind of an interesting thing, because you are friends, and the three movies that probably Jeremy is most, certainly the last two that Jeremy is most known for, you guys have become synonymous as working together. So what would somebody else do in that situation? But then, what would you guys do scoring a film for a different director? I mean, I'm a huge fan of Killing Them Safely, which was a score you did for a documentary about tasers. And honestly, I had no idea that could be an interesting subject. I didn't really have any kind of idea what to expect from the documentary itself. When it was when I heard the score, I heard the score first and then I saw the film. I personally would love to see you guys just score literally everything.
Oh, that's fantastic. So,
thank you.
So do we. So do mom and dad. So.
Excellent, excellent.
Some sort of retirement.
Is there actually kind of something that I usually ask my guests on a different podcast that we do here? If there were a dream project for you, past or present, what would it be and why?
We might have different answers for this.
Would you like me to go first?
You can go first.
I think they would change as over the course of what we hope is a long career with our tastes and with our, and we might not always be on the same page with this, but I can say without too many details, again, our oldest brother, Macon, a great actor, but also a screenwriter and now a director, and he's in pre-production on his first directorial debut.
Oh, very cool.
He will shoot in the next 6 or 7 weeks or so. And we will let him share any details about it as the time comes. But we're hired to work with him. And
fantastic.
it'll be we've worked on creative things together, but this will be the first time that the three of us, can directly collaborate on sort of a family project that I think.
Well, I agree with that. Yeah,
you agree with that.
Yeah, that's very cool. Of course. Yeah.
Without giving anything away, is this what genre of film is this?
This is tough. I would say dark comedy, maybe.
Comedy. Okay. Yeah, and I mean your question earlier about a preference of working with script early or a picture of some sort. They're different feelings that you get from reading on a page or from seeing a picture. There's all sorts of nuances.
Yeah.
So we are very familiar with the script, but he hasn't shot yet, and we're curious to see how it might sort of evolve and what certain actors might bring to the table. But there's a certain level of darkness to it that you might recognize from something like Blue Ruin, but I think quite a bit more comic relief and absurdity sort of as well.
So I can't think of a better way to end this now than the three of you guys all working together. That's something I'm definitely going to be looking out for. As you, ladies and gentlemen, should be doing, the Green Room soundtrack comes out on April 15th through Milan Records on CD and digitally. So Will, Brooke, thanks again for joining me, and I hope to talk to you again soon.
Likewise.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.